Hey, good morning, online church family. Thank you so much for joining us for another week of Christ Church of Orlando Worship Online. My name is Tori. I'm the executive pastor here, and it's my privilege to welcome you to our online service. Let me just say, you are in store for something pretty spectacular this morning. But before we get too deep in today's service, I want to take an opportunity just to tell you about some of the awesome things that are coming your way at Christ Church of Orlando. One of the things that we're most excited about that's coming up soon is our Creative Arts program. So the Creative Arts Initiative is a showcase night designed to highlight the artistic abilities of our kids and youth and young adults right here at Christ Church. And so we've got some students who have been working on their craft. Sometimes it's singing, some of it is arts, some of it is something in between. And so what we want to do is we want to invite you to come on out and help us celebrate these young people in the ways that God is using them to use their giftings to express love back to Him. And so we're going to be having a special evening that's all about these kids, and we're inviting you to be a part of it. That is going to be on July 21st at 7 p.m. right here in the Christ Church of Orlando main foyer. It's going to be a fun celebration. I hope that you'll come out as we cheer on our young people together. Speaking of our young people, they've got a very exciting week coming up in just a few weeks. On the week of July 26th through the 30th, they're going to be heading up to Camp Anderson for a week of fun, worship, and drawing near to God. And we want to say thank you to those of you through your generous support have sponsored so many of our kids to go to camp this year. We're excited to say that there's not a single kid who will not be able to go to camp this year because of finances. Because of your generosity, we're able to send a huge group of our young people up there. So thank you so much for giving and investing in our young adults here. We know that it's going to be a really, really exciting week for them. Speaking of giving, I want to say thank you to those of you who give each and every week through your tithes and your offerings. It's because of your consistent financial support that this summer has been one for the books for us as a church. As we're coming out of COVID and all of these new challenges, we've been able to press on towards God's call for our church full speed ahead because you've equipped us with the resources to do just that. Now, we have some bold, ambitious plans that God has laid on our heart for the fall, and those plans will only be made possible through your continued support. So we want to just encourage you to continue to give, continue to invest in what God is doing here. It's some pretty incredible stuff. And just remind you that you're never giving just to a church, you're always giving through a church. Your investment reaches right through us and into their community to be the hands and feet of Jesus. So thank you so much for investing here. There's plenty of ways to give. You can give through text. There's a number at the bottom of the screen. It's safe, it's simple, it's secure. You can also give by going through or going to our website. On the giving page, you'll find multiple ways that you can give, or you can give by check or cash and mailing that to the church at 2200 South Orange Avenue, Orlando, Florida, 32806. But however you choose to give, let me just say thank you so much on behalf of me, our team, for investing in what God is doing here. He's up to some great stuff, and thank you for being a part of it. Well, hey, thank you so much through your worship, through gifts. Why don't we worship the Lord through some music and some singing over the next few minutes?
Oh, Good morning, everybody. I'm glad you're here today. Are you glad you're here this morning? Amen. I love when we get together and the presence of the Lord shows up. I'm glad that you're here today, and I hope that those of you who are watching at home today are sensing the presence of the Lord also. We're glad to have all of you from Central Florida, all over the United States, even people from other countries that are watching us on this Sunday. Thank you for joining us. God is good, and we're joined together to lift him up. And so, everybody here in Christ Church, will you welcome everybody who's watching online today? Amen. Hey, today I want to talk to you for a few moments about walking in victory, that God wants you to walk in victory. The thing about walking in victory, though, is you have to be ready for victory. You have to be battle ready for victory. Somebody say victory. God wants you to have victory. And so today I'm going to take a look at a passage of scripture that really deals with this directly. I'd like for you to turn with me in your Bible to Ephesians, the sixth chapter. I'm going to get right to it today because I feel like God has a work that he wants to do through his word for you. Ephesians, the sixth chapter, and I'm going to read in the 10th chapter. And this really has to do with us being battle ready. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, stand. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. And in addition to this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. And with this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. I want to go back and read verse 10 and 11 again, and that's where I'm going to focus my thoughts today. I'm going to ask you to read it out loud with me. And if you don't have this passage memorized, this would be a passage worth memorizing. Take some time this week. Take some time and start to memorize this passage and commit it to you because I think that it helps you to be battle ready. Are you ready? Read out loud with me if you would in verse number 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. As we study this passage and as I was preparing for this, I wanted to talk to you for a few moments about how to study scripture. How to take a look at it, because a lot of times it seems like we just start to read and necessarily there is no context to it. So I want to take a few moments and tell you how I approach studying scripture. There are three questions that I generally ask when I begin to study a passage. First of all, who is the author? Who's the author? And we know that ultimately it is the word of God is God breathed. It's inspired by him, but he used human beings. He used men of old and they wrote what he inspired them to write. And in the case of this writing, it is the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul is writing this. And the Apostle Paul is an amazing story because at one point he was not a Christian. In fact, he was anti-Christian. He hated Christians and even murdered them. And then he had an encounter with God. And when he had this encounter with God, God turned him around and he began to be moved on by the Holy Spirit. He started to write letters. And when he wrote those letters, they were inspired by God. And what I love about the story of the Apostle Paul, he wrote 28% of the New Testament, 28% of the New Testament, a man who was once a God hater, a Christian hater, a Christ hater, and now he's writing the stories of God, the doctrines of the church. And I love that because what it says to me is God can use anyone he wants. God can take the worst people moving in the wrong direction and somehow he can touch them and change them, move them, open their eyes, and then they become something that God can be glorified in. The Apostle Paul was one of those people. And so he writes 28% of the New Testament. So let me talk to you a little bit about the Old Testament, New Testament. The Old Testament were the books of the Bible, the manuscripts of the Bible that really lead up, point us towards Christ. And then the New Testament is the revelation of Christ, his stories, his ministries, his teaching, his revelation of the kingdom of heaven. And it's the story of what the church did on his instruction. That's the New Testament. Paul writes 28% of that. He's the author of this book. And then the second thing that I do, I always ask myself, who is the audience? Who is he writing to? Well, this happens to be a church in a city named Ephesus. And Ephesus was a great city of commerce. It was a large city, a metropolitan area. It was a city where this church had been planted, and now this church was growing, and it was growing rapidly. And Paul begins to write this letter to them to give them some instruction of how they would really be able to be strong in God. It's the church at Ephesus. That's why the book is called Ephesians. In the same way, kind of like Americans or people from America are Americans. People from Italy are Italians. People from Apopka are rednecks. I don't know. I ran out of stuff. I love people from Apopka. God bless you wherever you are today. But that's what the church was in Ephesus. So this is the book of Ephesians. And so then the third thing I always ask is, what is the context? What is he trying to explain to them? What is the message he wants them to understand? And the message that he wants them to understand is spiritual warfare. That there's something that's going on beyond what you can see. There's activity that's happening that you cannot see, and yet you know somehow it's impacting your life. You can't see it, but you know that it's there. I tried to think of an example of that years ago when they started to talk about the cloud. Remember when people started first talking about the cloud? We were trying to explain it to somebody in the office, and we said, we're going to start to keep files in the cloud. And they were like, well, where is it? I'm like, it's in the cloud. And they said, well, where will I go to get it? You'll go to the cloud. And they're like, so where will my files be? And I'm like, in the cloud. And they're like, in the clouds? I'm like, no, not in the clouds, but in the cloud. It's kind of the same idea. The cloud is there. You can't see it, but you know that there's stuff there. In spiritual warfare, you cannot see it, but you know that there's stuff there. And so today I want to take a few moments and I want to talk to you about spiritual warfare, because there's spiritual warfare. You can't see it, but it's happening around you and it's happening in your life. Now I'm going to pause before I go any further in this message, and I want to tell you that people do take this to the extreme. They turn everything in life, every bad thing, every bad day into an attack from the enemy, and it's some kind of spiritual warfare. Everything that you're dealing with that's negative in your life is not the devil. Let me just say that. He might use it, but everything that you're dealing with is not the devil. Honestly, if you have a flat tire, the devil did not put nails in your driveway. He did not, you know. If you dropped a glass today, it's not a spiritual attack. If that glass broke all over the kitchen floor, it was not an attack from the enemy. That was just simply gravity and physics. That's what it was. And so on some level, there are some things that happen that aren't, it's not about the devil. The devil did not make you go broke. It was your application for a credit card at Macy's and a big sale. That's what made you go broke. The devil did not make you break your diet. That was you and Dairy Queen that did that. Honestly, the devil did not cause you to go back into that toxic relationship. Your flesh drove you back there. So everything is not the devil, but yet we would be amiss if we did not understand that there's spiritual warfare against your life. There's spiritual warfare against my life. And many of you, you could talk to me today and say something like, Pastor Paul, I know that my life should be further down the road. I know that I'm up against something. I don't know exactly what it is. I feel like I'm going around the same mountain over and over again. It seems like it's taken longer for me to get where I'm supposed to go. And you haven't said it, but the reality is there's an enemy against your soul and he's fighting against you. Let me say it this way. It shouldn't be this hard to pray. It shouldn't be hard for we as the people of God to worship. It shouldn't be hard for those of us who are Christians to be generous and give. It shouldn't be hard for us to come into the house of the Lord and just freely raise our hands and praise our God. It shouldn't be hard for us to go before Him when we're in the middle of something and just carry our cares before Him. What do you think that it is that you're up against that makes it that hard? I'm going to tell you what it is. It's the enemy fighting you. He doesn't want you to worship. He doesn't want you to serve. He doesn't want you to get to the other side of your prayer. And here's the reason why is because he knows that if you get to the other side of prayer, if you begin to pray and earnestly begin to pray, when you pray, God's going to open up the heavens. He's going to answer your prayer and you're going to see victory on the other side. The enemy does not want you to raise your hands and worship. And the reason why he doesn't want you to raise your hands and worship is because he knows God inhabits your praise. And he knows that God's going to show up. And when he shows up, when he shows up, all the power of who he is going to show up with him. The devil hates when you pray. The devil hates when you worship. The devil hates when you serve. The devil hates when you give. The devil hates when you read scripture. The devil hates when you're doing something that's going to move you, because it's going to bring victory for you. Everyone in this room right now today, you're in one of two categories. Either you're in the middle of a spiritual battle and you can sense it. Like you might not have even known it up until today. Like you knew there was something there, but now you can identify, I'm in a spiritual battle. I'm up against the enemy here. And you know when you're in the middle of that. And then there's some of you today, you came in and you're like, honestly, life is really good. Like God's good and I'm happy and things, like everything's going my way. Can I just tell you today, that's a place where you might want to be careful, because when the enemy is quiet, that doesn't mean he's not at work. He's working his plan next for you. He's got something up his sleeve and he's working on it right now. I was talking to someone the other day and they were telling me about their two-year-old child, their two-year-old daughter, and they were saying the worst time is not when they're making noise and you can hear them in the back room. It's when everything gets really quiet. You know when everything gets really quiet, like you get up off the couch and like, what's going on? You go in the room and right there you see like they've got markers and have written on the walls and there's paint in the cabinets and they've got mom's makeup all over the mirrors and it's just a mess. It's just like that with the enemy. When he's quiet, it's because he's into something. When he's quiet, it means that he's working on something. It's about to come. So all of us, either we're in it or we're about to go into battle. That's why we have to be battle ready. We have to get ready for what is ahead of us. And so there are 3 points I'm going to give to you today for you to get battle prepped. Are you ready? Here's the first one. You have to know your enemy. If you're going to win, you have to know that you have an enemy and you have to know who he is. Ephesians, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse again. Are you ready? Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against your boss. No, that's not what it says. What does it say? That you could take your stand against your next door neighbor. No. That you could take your stand against the person who's not in the same political party as you. No, that's not what it says. Here's what it says. So you could take your stand against your mother-in-law. No, that's not what it says either. Like somebody said to me after first service, they were like, but you don't know my mother-in-law. Here's what it says. He tells us who the enemy is. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil, the devil's schemes. You have an enemy. You have a real enemy. And let me tell you about him. Here's the first thing you should know about him is that he's destructive. He wants to destroy your life. He causes pain in the path of everything that he's involved in. Anybody remember back in 2004 when Hurricane Charlie came through Central Florida? Did anybody remember that? Man, I was in my house. I've never been that scared, honestly. They said it was going to go through Tampa, and it came right up through Port Charlotte and came up through Central Florida. The strongest winds were right over Belle Isle and right over Conway. In fact, here's what it looked like in Conway. My sister came over from Tampa because she thought she was going to get it, and she was like, we had a bad storm, but it wasn't. When she said, when I drove into Orlando, like you could see the destruction. Here's another picture. The whole place was destroyed. The whole place was destroyed. I mean, you didn't have to be there. You could see the destruction afterwards. Someone was talking to me recently about a community that they live in that went through a tornado, and they sent me a picture. Take a look at this, guys. You can see the path. I mean, there are houses right down here, not far. There are houses right down here that were in the same storm, but not that kind of destruction. You can see the path of the tornado that went right through there. And in your life and my life, and let me just tell you, there are some of you, I look at your life, and I don't even have to know the details. I can walk into your house. I can walk into your home. I can walk into your marriage. I can walk into your circumstance and see, man, this is the path of destruction from the enemy. Like, he's working havoc on your marriage. He's working havoc on your children. He's working havoc in your finances, that he's come to destroy your life. Here's what the book of John says, John the 10th chapter and the 10th verse. The thief comes only to kill and to steal and destroy. Somebody say destroy. What has he come to do? He's come to destroy. But I have come that you might have life and live it to the full. And honestly, we love that scripture. We say that scripture a lot. I come that you might have life more abundantly. Like, we love that. But we forget that the first portion of this is a real warning. The enemy is coming to kill and steal and destroy your life. He's a destroyer. The second thing you should know about him is that he's deceptive. Like, he's not going to walk in and go, hey, I'm the devil. Hi, how you doing? He's not going to do that. I have some concerns, and I don't mind telling you, because I feel like culture, and I'm not anti-Halloween, so just don't jump on that bandwagon with me today. But let me just tell you, Hollywood loves to minimize darkness. They want to entreat us to it. They want to make the devil appealing to us. They want darkness to be appealing to us, and so they even make costumes for the devil. Let me just tell you, when he shows up, he's not going to show up in a cute little red costume with a big long tail and a pitchfork. He's not going to do that. In fact, the Bible actually tells us in 2 Corinthians, the 11th chapter and the 14th verse, that Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. When he's walking in the door, he's going to make you think this is good for you. He's going to walk in the door making you think that whatever it is that he's deceiving you into is going to be a good thing for you. And then in the path behind you is going to be like that tornado. It's going to be a path of destruction. We have to be on alert that the enemy is deceptive. Here's the third thing we should know about him is that he is determined. He is absolutely, he's fixated on you. He's fixated on your family. He's fixated on your joy. He's fixated on your walk with God. He's fixated on your children. He's fixated on your family. He is coming after them. And let me just tell you, if you just think like, I'm just going to hide underneath all this and he's not coming. He's coming after you. And you would have thought that he would have gotten the message by now. Because 2,000 years ago, Christ defeated him at the cross. And you'd have thought, honestly, that he'd have just said, nah, I'll give up now. But that's not what he did. What he did was he decided that I'm going to go after those that love him. I'm going to go after them and I'm going to destroy their lives. And that's what he wants to do. He is determined to come after you. And I'm hoping that someone here today at Christ Church of Orlando will get the same kind of determination to be victorious as much as he is determined to destroy your life. That you're going to say, I'm not going to allow him. Woo! I'm not going to allow him to take my family down. I'm not going to allow him to take my joy. I'm not going to allow him to take my peace. I'm going to follow God. I'm going to stand. I am determined to stand in God. 1 Peter, the 5th chapter says this, be self-controlled and alert. Be alert about this thing. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And there's a reason why he wants to devour you, because he knows your potential. He knows that God created you with works assigned before you were born, acts of righteousness that would bring glory to God, and he wants to devour that. He wants to stop you. He knows your potential to do damage to his kingdom. The enemy's not coming after you because he wants your car. Honestly, he's not coming after you even because of your past mistakes. He's coming after you because of your future potential. And your future potential has the power to do damage to his kingdom. And so he's coming after you so you won't mess with him. Today, I'm going to say, stand up. Be strong. Don't allow yourself to be deceived. The enemy might be attacking, but you can be victorious. Somebody needs to say today, I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to stop. I'm going to keep fighting. I'm going to keep fighting until I'm victorious in the name of Jesus. Amen. You have to know who your enemy is. Here's the second thing you should know is you have to know that you have a part in this. Not only do you have an enemy that you need to know, you have to know your part. You have a part to play in this when it comes to your life. Here's what it says in Ephesians, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse again. Finally, be strong. One of the things that I always observe when I read these kind of passages is it wouldn't have been instructed to us if it wasn't possible. Be strong. Finally, be strong. Be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand. Finally, be strong. Be strong in the natural. Like, we know what it's like to be strong in the natural. You have to train. If you're going to go to a marathon, you have to train. If you're going to go into the army, they go to boot camp because they're getting ready to go to war. They have to train for that. In the very same way, you have to train physically. You're training physically for some kind of a battle, but then you have to train spiritually for supernatural warfare. Here's what it looks like. I'm going to invite these guys to come up. Joel and Jose, you come up here with me. Give them a big hand as they're coming up today. Let me take a few moments here and let me talk to you first a second. Everybody, this is Joel. Joel, where are you going to school, Joel?
Florida Atlantic University.
He's going to Florida Atlantic University, and baseball player. He's been just an awesome baseball player here in Central Florida. Tell everybody what you're studying.
Finance.
Finance. You're going back in just a couple of weeks. Everybody, will you just make sure you pray for him, cover him in prayer when he goes back. And everybody, this is Jose. You have a microphone.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Jose, tell everybody about your family. Tell us a little bit about you.
Happily married, a business owner, love to work out, and love to do a little bit of coaching as well.
If you don't follow him on Instagram or on Facebook, he's a weightlifter. Okay, so what have you lifted?
Bench press 315.
315. Yeah. Wow, I've bench pressed 315 donuts. You know? Here we go. So here's the deal. This is what it looks like spiritually. So come on. We're gonna do an exercise with him.
All right, you ready? Listen,
he's going to do some coaching here.
Awesome. All right. Let's keep those elbows a little bit closer to your sides, and let's go ahead and start pressing. Nice and controlled. 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's hold that one right there.
Yeah. Okay. Can we do one more set?
Sure.
Let's all get involved. You know, they say, like, by emotionally involving yourself, it's almost the same thing as though you're doing it. Here we go. Okay, let's just do 6 more. You ready?
Okay.
Count it out for us, man.
Okay, you ready? One, two, three, four, five, six.
That's awesome. Hold. Awesome. Okay, so let me just... You okay? Can you hold that? How long can you hold that? I only have about 20 more minutes, so just hold on. Okay, so... This is what it looks like in our lives. What we do is we talk ourselves into something like, I'm just going to be strong. I'm having some problems. I'm just going to find it in myself. I'm going to tough it out. I'm going through a difficulty. I'm tough. I'll just tough my... through the economy, I'll just be tough. I'm tougher than the people around me. And spiritually, we just kind of talk ourselves. We kind of psych ourselves up that we're going to be tough. Like... But here's the dilemma with this. That's not spiritual. When it comes to your spiritual life, when it comes to the activity, the battles that you're against, here's what it says in Ephesians, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse. Are you ready? Read this with me again. Be strong. Do it again. Be strong. Be strong in yourself. No. In yourself, you're going to be in trouble. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Your strength has to come from him. Here's what the instruction to Joshua in Joshua, the 1st chapter and the 9th verse. God says, have I not commanded you be strong and courageous? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you. How can you not be discouraged or terrified? Because somebody say it, the Lord your God. because the Lord your God is with you. Psalmist David said in Psalm 73, my flesh and my heart may fail. Anybody ever felt that way? My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Habakkuk, the third chapter says, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of deer and enables me to go to the heights. Isaiah 35 verse 4 says, it tells us where we get our strength. To those who have fearful hearts, if you have anxiety, if you're working through panic, be strong and do not fear. Your Lord will come. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance and he will give divine retribution and he will come to save you. Somebody ought to praise him that he's going to come and save you. So what does it mean for us to be strong in the Lord? How do we get strong in the Lord? How you get strong in the Lord is when you're taking time in Scripture. You're getting strong in the Lord. When you're taking time in worship, you're getting strong in the Lord. When you're taking time in prayer, you're getting strong in the Lord. When you're taking time to be in His presence, you're relying on His strength. Being strong in the Lord is not about God giving you strength, because what we pray is we pray, Lord, give me strength. Lord, give me strength. He doesn't want to give you strength. Be strong in the Lord is not about Him giving you strength. It's about Him becoming your strength. That He's the reason why you're strong. And then on the other side, the awesome thing about that is on the other side, people will praise God. So here we go. We're gonna do, you still holding on, man? Here we go. So this is what it looks like in the life of a believer. You saw what it looked like when he was on his own, but now he's been in the battle for a while. He's been lifting this. Ooh. Some of you have been lifting a weight for a long time, like you've been carrying this thing, and like your strength is left out. You don't even know exactly how you're going to make it because your strength is depleted, and this is how you're going to do it. You're going to be strong in the Lord, and here's how we're strong in the Lord. Are you ready? The Holy Spirit comes along. Yeah. In worship, in prayer, in Scripture. Yeah, to the people around us. Let me just tell you, to the people around us, they see us lifting the weights. They see us doing it. They think that we're doing it. But all along, just do it one more time. Here we go. Just three more. Are you ready? You got it. It's the Holy Spirit. He's the strength underneath it. Yeah, give these guys a big hand. Thank you so much. The world around you, they can't see what your strength is. They can't see that it's not you all along. They'll be like, tell me what your routine is. Tell me who you follow. I bet you've been watching Oprah. Listen, your strength does not come from Oprah. Your strength comes from the Lord. He is your strength. Amen. Here's what the Apostle Paul said when he was being tested over and over and over again. Having to go through battle over and over again. The voice of the Lord spoke to him in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter and the 9th verse. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. And the Apostle Paul says, therefore I will boast more gladly about my weaknesses. When I can't lift the weights, when I can't hold on to it anymore, I can't just power up and go, I'll do it. I'll just power through this thing. Instead, I'm going to boast about my weaknesses so Christ's power will rest in me. When I'm depleted, it becomes Christ's power. My greatest strength is found at my point of greatest surrender. My greatest strength is found at my point of my greatest weakness, because my strength is not my strength. It's God. It's Him. It's He who gives me strength. So you have to know where your source is. Here's the third thing that you need to know. You have to know your odds. You have to know your odds. Anytime that there's some kind of an event taking place where there's a challenge, anytime there's a battle, anytime there's a sports competition, they start to put out the odds. The odds are 10 to 1. The odds are 8 to 1. The odds are 90 to 1. Let me say clearly, you have to know your odds. And I don't want to sound like an alarmist, but in the natural, the odds are not good. In the natural, your odds are not good. When you're in spiritual warfare, you're going to face a lot of things And over the years, like some of you have faced some real battles. And the enemy has gotten really good at his job. He's had thousands of years to get good at his job. He's had thousands of years to practice targeting you and taking you down. So when it comes to the battle, the odds are against you. When it comes to the battle in your marriage, all you have to do is Google the statistics of marriages. The odds are against you. When it comes to your success, the odds are against you. When it comes to your children growing up to be Christians, the odds are against you. When it comes to you living without sickness or disease and living in health, the odds are against you. The odds are against you for changing the world. It's pretty slim. If you put everything on a scale of 1 to 10, and we start out in the aspect of everything begins at a 1, the odds are against you that you'll ever get past a 2 or a 3 in most areas of your life. But the awesome thing that I've learned in my life is that the difficulty is always measured by the capacity of the agent who is performing the action. The difficulty is measured in the capacity of the agent that is performing the action. Seriously, you put me on this bench up here, the agent cannot perform. You put someone like Jose up here, and Jose can perform. So when it comes to the strength in my life, in myself, I have no strength. In myself, I have no power. But the agent who lives inside of me has all the power. The Holy Spirit comes, and actually, one of the things about him is that Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will give you. He will be your power because he will dwell inside of you. Whew. Today, I have good news for you, that if God is for you, who can be against you? Now, if it's up to you, you're going to lose. But if it's up to God, you'll be victorious. So God is for you today. I'm going to declare this over you today, and I didn't do this in the first service, but you can be victorious. You can have freedom. You can have healthy relationships. You can succeed because God is for you. You can have freedom from anxiety. You can have freedom from fear. You can succeed because God, he is the source and the strength of your life. The Apostle Paul isn't saying that it's up to you. The Apostle Paul is saying that your strength comes from the Lord. When I was growing up, and this is, I'm going to close here in a second, but when I was growing up, one of the things that would take place, we lived in my grandmother's house, and my grandmother was a Czechoslovakian woman, came over from the old country, knew English, but her English was very broken. And so one of the things that we would love is on Friday nights, she would watch studio wrestling. Anybody remember studio wrestling? I'm not talking about the sophisticated stuff they got out there now. I'm talking about studio wrestling. Like where they, and so there'd be these wrestlers, and like some people might say it was all fake or drama, but my grandmother, she would fight you over that because she believed Bruno San Martino. Like, so he'd be in the battle, and she'd start yelling, "Come on, come on, come on!" And then she'd break into Slovak, and like we knew she was, we were afraid to find out what those words she was saying. But you know what? Then eventually, you know, they went on to become WWF, and then WWE, I guess it is now, and it's pretty awesome to watch that. But you know what? My favorite part about all of that is I love when there's teams. Like when they do the teams and there's two, you have a partner with you, and what takes place is when you're in battle, like somebody's wrestling, and you have somebody that's coming after you. I love to watch it when, like, even the good guy, you know that the good guy is supposed to win this, and then somehow, like, the awful person starts to get after him, knocks him down, and the good guy, he's trying to get to his tag team partner. He's down on his knees, and he's like, just reaching as hard as he can to get to his partner. And then that awful guy comes along and he knocks him down, pins him down, puts all the full weight of himself on him. And there he is. Like, you think that the battle's completely over. And at that moment, you could see the guy on the mat with his hand reaching out to his partner, reaching out. And right then, he gets close enough, reaches out far enough that his partner tags his hand, and then his partner comes in fresh and full of strength, and he takes on that enemy, and he wins the battle for him. Man, I love when that happens. And it's the very same way in your life, man. Like, the enemy's been chasing you, knocked you down, and you're crawling. And man, you've been reaching out, and then he comes after with a second battle, and he knocks you down, pins you down on the mat, and you're feeling the full weight of the enemy on you, and you don't even have the strength to get up. But all you have to do, honestly, is reach. It's the reach. It's reaching out for your partner. It's reaching out for the one who has all the strength. And that's why I love to come to Christ Church, and I love when we get together and we begin to sing and the presence of the Holy Spirit fills this room. And you might not fully understand why we worship the way we worship, but I have to tell you, there are some of us, when we get in this place, we know the enemy's knocked us down and he's pinned us down and we're feeling his weight. And when you see the person standing next to you putting their hands up in the air, it might just look like religion to you, but for them, it's the reach. It's reaching up to touch God's hand of power. And today I'm going to tell you, some of you, what you need to do is reach up for the presence of God. Reach up for the power of God. Reach up for his strength in his word. Reach up for strength in prayer. Reach up for praise. And when you do, all that he is comes along and gives you strength. Today, you don't have to be strong in yourself. You have to be strong in the Lord. Let him be your strength. Some of you today, you're here today, and you could say, Pastor Paul, I've been doing it on my own. I'm just out of strength. I need supernatural strength. I know that the battle I'm up against is not just me. I know that it's the enemy. We're going to pray in these next few moments, and we're going to ask the Lord that as you reach out to him, he's going to give you victory. Amen. Amen. Let me pray for you here. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you in the name of Jesus, and I thank you, dear Lord, for your blessings. I thank you, dear Lord, for the promise that we can be strong, but it's not our strength. It's in your strength, in the power of your might. And so, Lord, I'm asking you that you'll fulfill your promise as we reach today. As we do what we know we're supposed to do, and that is reach out to lay hold of your strength, that our weakness, it's an invitation for you to come in your strength. So today, when it comes to addiction, when it comes to habits, and when it comes to thoughts, and when it comes to battles in families and finances, and people who are walking up against difficulties, Lord, today we're reaching out and asking you that your strength will be in us for victory in the name of Jesus.
Before the Lord.
Hey, what an awesome message we just heard about the armor of God. Let me just encourage you this week, suit up, put on the full armor of God and allow God to walk with you each and every day so that you can be triumphant, victorious in everything that you encounter. Hey, we've got some more awesome messages of continuing this idea over the next few weeks. I hope that you'll tune in and join us for those. If it's your first time with us today, let me just say thank you so much for watching, connecting with us today. God is doing some really exciting things here at Christ Church, and we're glad that you're a part of it, even if you're just connecting with us online. Thank you for being there. If it is your first time, we would love to connect with you. There's a connection card that you can fill out digitally. Go to christchurchorl.org/connect. You can fill it out. And even though we're not connecting physically, we would love to connect with you digitally and get your name and just thank you for being a part of today's service. Well, hey, before we leave, let me say God's blessing over you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you, and may the Lord keep you in His peace. Go in the peace and the power of God. God loves you, and we love you, Christ Church.